Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to demonstrate some simple techniques to create this effect. So essentially, I've got a mesh here, and there's a set of invisible particles, or raindrops if you like, falling on the mesh, and then causing drips to fall down the mesh, and as they do so, the mesh is revealed. So to begin with, let's just add a mesh into the scene. So I'm just going to add a monkey head, Suzanne, and let's just improve it by using Control 2 to simply add a subdivision surface, and I'll set it to shade smooth. Just for simplicity, I'm going to apply that subdivision surface. You wouldn't normally do that. So this is going to be our basic mesh, and this is what we're going to work on. We can see it up here as Suzanne. So one of the key important things is that you unwrap your mesh rather than going into unwrapping here, because I've used the Suzanne head. We come into the UV image editor and I go into edit mode, you can see Suzanne is already unwrapped. And without going into a long explanation of what UV unwrapping is, you can see here, there's the face of Suzanne and it's as if she's been skinned and laid out flat on a flat surface. So it's turning this 3D shape into a 2D shape that you can then use to put 2D textures and images onto. So the next thing I'm going to do is add another mesh. It could be any shape really. I just used an icosphere. I'll make it a bit smaller and then I'm going to put it somewhere like this. What I want is for the majority of the droplets to fall on the face. I could just put it above, but I wanted to sort of have them traveling in a direction other than just straight down. So you can see it's in line with, roughly in line with the Suzanne head, but above it and slightly in front. I'm going to do this in EV, by the way. So let's come up here and change this to EV. And then we'll come down here under particle systems with my icosphere selected and we'll say new particle system. Accept the defaults to begin with and we'll just press play. And you can see we've just got particles that are just being emitted from the normal. So some of them are being pushed upwards before they then fall down through gravity. What I want to do is give them a slight vector. So do need to make sure that they run for long enough. They're running for 200 frames at the moment. So they start emitting at frame one and run for 200 frames. I'm going to put it up to 250, the full length of this animation. The lifetime just needs to be long enough that they fall below the level of the head. 50 is probably longer than it needs to be, but I'm not going to worry too much about that at the moment. If you start to have so many particles that there's a problem, then you can improve that by reducing the lifetime. So I'm going to increase the normal velocity here. So if I increase that a lot, you can see how they are firing out from the normals. But I only used about a value of 2, so we won't go too far. It just adds a bit more randomness to when the particles reach the head. And then I'm going to add some Y velocity, so you can should be able to see now how they're pushing out towards the head. If we look from above, you can see that more clearly. So it's as if somebody's got a shower head and is pointing it toward the target. And we'll just increase that a little bit more just until the majority of the particles are either hitting the head or at least getting close to it. Maybe slightly more again, we'll go up to 5. That's maybe too much, 4.25. We can add a little bit of randomization to the velocity, just again, put some variation in there. Under render, currently I've got halo, but I'll turn off show emitter. So that will just mean when we render, that the emitter itself won't be shown and we won't even be seeing these particles. Obviously you could do particles that you can see. And then we can play with the scale. So I'll put the scale up to 0.1, but I'll add some scale randomness so we get some variation in the size. It doesn't seem to show that. Effectively they are different sizes now. The scale can vary by up to 80% of that 0.1. The next thing we want to do is select our head and come down to here. We'll stop the animation now, which is physics properties, and click dynamic paint. And comes up as defaulting to canvas and we'll add a canvas. We'll leave it at surface. I change this to image sequence because if you use vertex, it's not going to look too good. And set this up to a reasonable resolution. I went to 1024. You may want to consider going even higher depending on what the results look like and make sure anti-alias is on. Make sure that the frames start and end are appropriate to your animation. So in my case, 1 to 250. You can add substeps. So if you find it's very jerky, you can add some substeps in here. So let's put 2 and see how that does. Dry means that the effect will disappear over time. And then under effects, I added drip. So this is where once a particle has created a droplet hitting the head, it will then appear to drip as it falls away from the head. And in there, you've got some settings. So I just accepted the default for those. I didn't change them. If you want it to shrink, as it progresses, you can use that, but I didn't change anything else there. And then we need to go to output, and by default, it will just use a path that's based on the path for Blender, and that's fine. But if you want to use a specific path, then you click that. You can see I've got my old render in there, and you can create a folder for that cache. So there it is, and I'll just accept that. So now we've got a specific folder, which is that cache. Now, once you've UV unwrapped, you can then select the UV map, and you can determine what kind of image file to create. I just left it on default PNG. But I also added wet maps. So paint maps is going to show you where the droplet has hit the head, and then the wet map is going to give you information that describes how the paint drips down the head. They both will drip down the head, but this will give you, as it were, the edge of the drip, because the drip obviously is on the surface and has an element of 3D to it. I left them at default names, so it's going to create images with these names in them. You could put them in separate places if you want, but they do have separate names, so that's fine. So before we can bake the image sequence, we need to set up a brush. So we now select our sphere up here, again click Dynamic Paint, this time change it to Brush, and click Add Brush. Don't really need to change anything here, except when we come down to Source, change that to Particle System, and just select the particle system you've created. I said use particles radius, because of course we've got some variation in that radius, and then we can go back to our head, come down to here, and click Bake, and it will take a little while. So there we are. So if we go to the folder now and we have a look, you can see that we start to get images that are reflecting these particles impacting with the head, and you can see that the drips are then dripping down. And if we scan down to the wet map, you can see there's the head map, and you can then see these drips dripping down the head. So now we just need to represent that. So if we come up here to the shader editor, we'll go to materials and we'll say new. So I'm just going to leave that as a base material there for the moment. Maybe we'll give it slightly golden color, and we'll go to preview mode, and I'll set the background to a dark background for now. I'll add a lamp, and we'll try and turn the brightness of that up a little bit and the radius up a little. And while I'm at it, let's go to world view, and we'll say use nodes for the world. And I'm going to add an environment texture. You can see that appears there, and I'm just going to add an HDRI just to give me a general illumination. I don't want it too bright. I'm going to use this sort of nighttime sky, and you can see there it is, giving me some more general illumination, but I don't want the sky to be visible. So I've shown this little trick before. I'm going to add a mix shader, drop that there, duplicate the background, but nothing else going into that side. That goes to the other side of the mix shader. So on the one side, we get black, on the other side, we get our sky texture. And then I'm going to add an input, which is light path. And I'm going to say is camera ray as the decider as to what's shown. So what's now happening is light from our HDRI is reflecting and illuminating on our object, our head here. But if it is coming straight to the camera from the background, we're not seeing it. We're only seeing the black background. So that just gives you a nice way to give some general illumination without actually having a distracting HDRI in the background. It's a cheat, really. I'm just going to turn that spotlight up a little bit and bring it to the front. It saves me doing a three-point light system or anything like that. Okay, so back to our object. I'm going to come some way in to where the particles are showing so that we know we've got some dynamic paint effect on them. I'm going to add texture, which is an image sequence, and that will open a new window. I'll go to my cache folder, and I'm going to select all of the paint map files to begin with. So I just held shift down there to do that, and then say import image sequence and drop that there. And you can see it's set it to 250 frames. You could just select the first file and then type in 250. Make sure you click auto refresh. And now if I just put that color output straight into base color, you can now see what's happening. It's hard to see the individual particles causing the drips. You can just about see one impacting there. There, you see it left a mark, and then you get a drip forming that travels down the head. So that's the paint map. And what I think I'm going to do now is select that icosphere and unclick here to take it away from render, and unclick here to take it away from view. Now we can't see those particles, but we can see the effect because we baked the paint map. So I'm now going to add another texture, which is an image sequence. and this time I'm going to select the wet map. Again, click auto refresh, so if I put that one in and press play, you can see how it's related, but now you can see we're having some effects because of the slight angles that are created on the object, because obviously the object is still not that high a poly. But you can now see that what this is representing is the higher spots of the drips. And because we've got some angular elements to the head, if I turn off, set it to shade flat, there they are. They're actually affecting the drip. So I could, if my model was of a higher quality, add more subdivisions to it. That would obviously remove that effect, but it's actually a good way to show what's going on in this. So you can add a subdivision surface, but if you do that, make sure that the dynamic paint is after the subdivision surface, otherwise it won't take account of it. So we'll probably want to rebake this in a minute just to get rid of that effect. But before we do, we now need to use these two effects. So if you want to do the effect that I did, then the first thing I'm going to add is the usual under converters color ramp. I set it to something like that. You'll need to tweak it, but basically both the pointers off toward the left hand side. Take the paint map into there and then use the output of that into the alpha input on here. And you can see the head has disappeared. But when we start the animation, you can see how it's coming back. Now, I ended up putting a background, which was just a plane, because otherwise it just looked like it was a black object that was then being covered in paint. And obviously the point was to have an invisible object that became visible. So I'll just add a subdivision surface on that and set it to shade smooth. Now you can see at the moment it is indeed a black object. And the reason for that is because we haven't turned on transparency for materials, remembering we're in EV, not cycles. So we come down to here in the settings, or you can press N and you can see them up here under options. And we need to just select one of these mechanisms for transparent materials. So I'll just go to hashed for both. And now you can see the head's disappeared if I turn off the outliner, and we can see our material appearing with the paint. And that's doing quite a good job. Now that's the majority of it, but I'll just take you through the last little bits I did to give you that sort of metallic effect, as well as the wet map. So here's our wet map. I need another color ramp. Color ramps just give you the ability to control how it's working. And I'll take the output of that into here. I flipped the color ramp for this, but still brought it over here, sort of quite close together. I actually used ease for this one at the top, which might change the sharpness slightly. Gives you a slightly softer edge. But this one I set to cardinal, which isn't a complete change from one to the other, but it's a more sharp fall off between black and white. And then I used that to drive the metallic input here. And I set roughness down quite low. Obviously, that's all up to you. Perhaps not quite that low for this particular one. Otherwise, it'll be difficult to see. So we go back to the beginning, you can see our shape is coming in there. I'll let it go a bit further. What I also then did, I'll add another color ramp and take the output of the wet map into that as well. And then added, under vector, a bump node. The output of this new color ramp goes into there, into height. I'll flip this again, just so that we've got white at the top. And then bring this side down a little bit. And I set it to B-spline, which is the most gentle and gradual of fall-offs. I had a strength of somewhere around 0.6, something like that. And any output into the normal input. It'll take a moment to recalculate, and there we go. Now you can remember we had an artifact caused by the shapes. The fact that there are facets in the model, even if we can't see them because of the way it's being shaded. And you can now see they're coming through. And we'll see if we can improve that in a moment. And then just to add a little bit more to it, I added a texture, which is a noise texture. Set that to a scale of about 100. And then add, under converters, a math node, set that to multiply and a value of about 0.05, connect those together and put them into displacement. Should have been 0.05 there, so that's a bit high at the moment. This seems to slow it down quite a lot, interestingly. So we'll go for 0.05 there, maybe even lower than that, 0.025. So that just gives you this sort of crinkled surface, even lower. There we go. And maybe we'll go up to 200 on the noise. We come up to here, and we can turn on screen space reflections, turn off half res trace, and that'll give you a sort of slightly higher quality of render. Under shadows, I put that up slightly, questionable whether it made much difference. And we'll say soft shadows, and you can see what's going on there. So I'll just do a quick rebake after adding another subsurface. So if I go back to shade flat, and let's put a control 2 on there, so that's still shaded flat, but now the subdivisions are much higher. Maybe go even higher than that. We'll go up to 3. So that's a lot of vertices now. We're up to 500,000 faces. And then we'll put that above the dynamic paint. Won't make any difference yet, because of course what we've got to do is rebake. And that's going to take a little time. So I'll stop the recording and we'll come back when that's done. So there you go. So I hope you found that tutorial useful. If you did, let me know. I will upload the original file for my Patreons to try out, and you can use it for any purpose. Otherwise, I will see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.